Hello student, welcome back. This is Vasant Naik from Vastech channel. So we'll continue fourth module ARM of 17CS44. So in last video you must have seen the introduction to ARM. So here we will see ARM bus technology. ARM bus technology is called as AMBA bus technology. So AMBA bus technology is further divided into AHB, ASB, AP, APB. AHB means high performance bus, ASB means system bus, APB means peripheral bus. So all these are part of AMBA bus technology. Embedded device use on chip bus, that is internal to the chip. You know what is a bus? Bus is a group of lines which connects a group of signals which connects input, output and memory, all those device. So here you can see direct memory access bus master also, and in this diagram you can see what is the advantage of AMBA AHB, AMBA ASB and AMBA APB. So meanwhile, AMBA, what is the full form of AMBA? Advanced Microcontroller Bus Architecture. So AMBA AHB, high performance bus, provides high performance pipelined operations, multiple bus masters, bus transfer, AMBA system bus. System bus is related which connects the internal this architecture. So which is provides high performance pipelined operation, etc. Then AMBA peripheral bus, low power, latched address control, simple interface, all those are the different architecture of AMBA. So there are two different classes of device attached to the bus. ARM processor core is a bus master, a logical device capable of initiating data transfer. Peripheral tends to a bus slaves, a logical device capable of only responding to a transfer of request. The bus has two architecture. Physical level covers the electrical characteristics and protocol covers the logical rules for communication. AMBA bus protocol. AMBA means Advanced Microcontroller Bus Architecture. So the first AMBA bus was introduced in 1996. So the first AMBA bus introduced were AMBA system bus ASB, AMBA peripheral bus, later ARM introduced ARM high performance bus, that is called as AHB. So AMBA bus has three components. First was AMBA system bus and peripheral bus. Later it was introduced AMBA high performance bus. Using AMBA, peripheral designers can reuse the same design on multiple projects. Peripheral can simply bolted onto the on-chip bus without having to redesign an interface for each different processor architecture. AMBA provides high data throughput than ASB. AHB provides high data throughput than ASB because it is based on the centralized multiplexed bus scheme rather than ASB bidirectional bus design. This changes allows ASB bus to run at higher clock speed. Please remember these points. So in AHB there are two versions. That is called as multi-layer AHB, allows multiple active bus masters. One is called as AHB Lite, is a subset of AHB and it is limited to single bus master. The other one is which makes use of three buses, that is AHB bus, APB bus and bus for external peripherals. So AHB has two versions. One is called as multi-layer AHB, other one is AHB Lite. Multi-layer AHB bus allows multiple active bus masters. AHB Lite is a subset of AHB bus and it is limited to single bus master. That means single bus master controller is there. Here multiple bus master controllers are there. Memory. Embedded system has to have some form of memory to store and execute the code. So memories are, the hierarchy of memory is, here you can see the hierarchy of memory, cache, main memory and secondary. So the performance of the cache, because cache is near to the processor or it is internal to the processor, naturally the performance of the cache is better compared to main memory. Main memory is external, external to the processor. Compared to that one, secondary storage, whose performance is poor, because secondary storage is nothing but our hard disk. So hard disk performance is poor, which contains some motor and other device and all, which is the poor compared to this one. So cache is high performance, main memory is next, next is secondary storage. So you can see here, CPU and cache and main memory. So which is faster? Here it is faster, here it is slower. So you can see further design, CPU, level 1 cache, level 2 cache, level 3 cache and main memory. So caches are further classified into level 1 and level 2, level 3. Level 1 and level 2 means normally built in inside the processor. Level 3 is sometimes outside the processor. Level 3 cache, that is somewhat slower, and main memory is anyway outside the processor. So memory width. So in the year, ARM can access 8-bit data, 16-bit data, 32-bit data or 64-bit data. So you can see here, ARM has got two type of instruction set, 32-bit instruction set and 16-bit instruction set. So suppose 8-bit memory, it takes 16-bit 2 cycle. So 32-bit, it takes 4 cycle. 16-bit, it takes 16-bit instruction 1 cycle and 32 2 cycle. 32-bit memory, it takes both 1-1 cycle. So we have in memory, ROM and flash ROM. Flash ROMs are used in embedded system, you know that one. Other than that, dynamic RAM. Dynamic RAM means the RAM whose content has to be refreshed every now and then, because that makes use of capacitor as to store the this one charges. So this capacitor will discharge, this has to repressed every now and then. That is why it is called as dynamic random access memory, and it is somewhat slower compared to static random access memory, which is doesn't require refreshing and which is faster, and the cost of SRAM is also high, and the cost of SRAM is also high. Nowadays we are getting synchronous dynamic random access memory. Synchronous means the speed of the RAM is synchronized with the processor speed. That means they both can work in sync. That's why it is called a synchronous dynamic RAM. So this is the difference between dynamic RAM and static RAM. Dynamic RAM made of capacitor, static RAM made of flip-flops, transistors, flip-flops. Data storage in the form of charge, data storage in the form of voltage. Small in size, less expensive, large in size, much expensive. High storage capacity, low storage capacity. Slow but consume less power, faster but consume more power. All these are the advantages and disadvantages. Peripheral devices, I will not explain, you know what are the peripheral devices we can use with the embedded systems. Controllers, what are the device we use as a controller? There are two types of controller, memory controller and interrupt controller. Memory controller is configured in the hardware, and this will control the memory operations. And interrupt controller provides interrupt facility. There are two types of interrupt controllers are available in ARM. One is a standard interrupt controller, second one is a vector interrupt controller. Standard interrupt control sends an interrupt signal to the processor core when the external device is requesting service. Vector interrupt controller is more powerful than standard interrupt controller because it will give priority to the interrupts, simplifies and determination of which device can be interrupted. All these things are done with the vector interrupt control. So embedded system software, how the architecture of embedded system. So architecture of embedded system you have already seen. You can write along with that this also. At the bottom level, hardware device comes. Above the hardware, we have something. Suppose if you take your mobile device, hardware, above the hardware, you have something called as operating system. Operating system, we have Android operating system. Android operating system contains initialization and device drivers. That means when you switch on your mobile system, first it will initialize and it device drivers are loaded, then operating system is loaded, and now you can say your mobile is booted. Above that, you are loading different app. So this is the architecture of embedded system normally. So it contains initialization code, operating system, device drivers and applications. So boot code takes the processor from the reset to state 2 where the operating system can run. This is process is called as booting. So you have seen in the system also, when you switch on your system like your PC, initially you will see that black screen with configuration information. That is it will display what type of processor is there, how much memory is there, all those information on your monitor you will get. This is called as power on self test. Power on self test means there is a small program on ROM. There is a small program that is called basic output input output system on ROM that will be executed when you switch on the machine first, and because of that you will get that black screen with all those things. After that it will try to load the operating system from hard disk to the RAM. Once the operating system is loaded to the RAM, we can say system is booted. So that is the booting procedure in the machine. ARM operating system, ARM supports 50 operating system. The main operating categories are called as platform operating system and real-time operating system, RTOS. So real-time operating systems are used in hard real-time applications. So ARM processor fundamentals. So what is the ARM processor fundamentals? You have to see the ARM processor fundamentals. This architecture is called as ARM data flow model. From the exam point of view, it is very important. We will see this in the next session.